remember processes of God and things that he processes us in. And, you know, I wish it was magical. I wish it was like instant transformation that you would know doesn't happen and everything that happened. But instead, there's always something going on with God in you that you may not even be aware of, and be aware of what, why he's doing those things. You know, because you're looking at basically life out of the dark glasses that we've been looking at life at for so long. And here God sees, see, he don't just see you as you are, he sees you as you will be, or in him you are. So he's not looking, and I don't know, see, I don't have the expertise nor you to sit down and create a man. No matter, even though I'm a man, but I don't know how, I wouldn't know how to go about sitting down, putting some mud together, and creating a man. That's way beyond my pay grade. So I don't know how to do that. The only one that really knows how to do that is the one that calls. And so it takes him to make us. See, we don't even know what his image is. We really don't. That's why the Bible said in Isaiah, I think it talks about that his image was marred more than any man. See, they messed him up. They marred his image. They messed his image up so much, like no other man's image was ever messed up. And even today, I still feel like what we have done in the past as preaching Jesus is still marring his image. That's not one man's ever image was ever marred more than his. And so when we go about trying to create an image of God, which we can't, if you go back and read, the Bible say he created us in his image and in his likeness did he make us. So only God knows exactly how he looks. And I think when we talk about how God looks, we're not really talking about an external thing. We're not talking about, does he have chariots, riding on chariots. I don't think we're talking about that. I think the image of God is all the attributes and all the qualities of God being seen by man. That's why the Bible said in one place, no man has seen God at any time. But yet we see where God is being. We see where, when God is manifested, we can see those things. And yet, still to say the image of God, he has to create that image so that we will have the image that he wants us to have. That brings another problem, is because if we're not careful, we get in the cookie cutter program where that someone have designated this is the image. And so from that point on, everybody's trying to project this image as being that of God, which has been a real bad problem, because what people have showed people that is God is not God. And this is what has happened to us now, because we have the perception of God that is not true God. First thing you got to know, and you have to be able to see from the beginning, the heartbeat of God. Because understanding his heartbeat then allows you to get a perception of God. How much does he love? You know, why did he make all this stuff? But that's a whole nother lesson. But we are, We are going to get to that, because I think one of the questions we have to ask ourselves, what did Jesus come to do? And I really think if we can answer that one, then it's going to relieve us of a whole lot of pressure. When we finally realize, what did he come to do? Did he come so he can give you a bunch of rules, so you can mess up, so he can fry you up in the boiler, cook you up? Did he come knowing that you couldn't keep up, so he was just waiting on you to mess up so he can kill you? I mean, and we preach this to the world. We got the world hating God, because every time something happened, we're in our pulpit banging on our pulpit, telling the world, this is God's judgment against y'all. And so, I mean, that's not our gospel message. That is not the gospel. And I think what we have preached to the people has been anything less than gospel. Because we have a people afraid of a God that wants to love them. And when you got a people that's afraid to be loved, you got a people that's afraid to love. And so now we're on guard. We're at war. We are fighting everybody on every hand. We are against this. We're against them. And it's not what I'm against. It's what I'm for. And since we're not for anything, we can only talk about what we're against. Why is that we can't tell people what we're for? I'm for righteousness. I'm for peace. I'm for joy. Well, we can't tell them that if that's not what we're for. But we can always say what we're against. Oh, we need to have a prayer meeting. You know, they just now open up a bunch of gambling joints in our city. We need to pray against that. Friend, you know, God could care less. If you want to go out there and spend your money like this, spend it. Go ahead, knock yourself out. But that God could care less how many gambling joints you got. Because if you're telling me that this is evil and you allow this evil to invade, where is your power? Why should I be against them? Maybe I should be for God, because I'll be for him. Then all those things I'm fighting against, maybe he can change those things. Amen. Well, praise God. Anyway, we want to read in Jeremiah chapter 18. You know, one of the things I always like to know, I say is I like to know where I am. Yes. More than anything in the world, I like to know where I am. I want to know what God is doing in me. I want to be able to interpret his action right. And I don't want to misinterpret anything when it comes to God. That's why I'm never in a hurry when it comes to God. I don't ever want to jump the gun when it comes to God. I just want to wait on it. Because if it's God, he ain't gonna turn you loose. If it's him, he ain't going to quit. You can be sure of one thing. Once God has sights on it, he got sights on it. So in Jeremiah chapter, get my over 50 glasses. Jeremiah 18, beginning at verse 1, it says, and the word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, there will I cause thee to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on the wheels. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hands of the potter, so he made it again, another vessel. It seemed good to the potter to make it. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter? Saith the Lord, behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in mine, O house of Israel. And that's one of the things about God. He is the only one that's self-determinate. He has determination. And we have many times talked about being in the potter's house, being the clay. He is the potter and we are the clay. But then we change our expertise shortly thereafter. We become the potter and try to tell God how to form the clay. And he even asked the question one time, you know, who art thou? Who are you? Are you the clay? Does the clay tell the potter, I want to be made thus and thus? Can the clay cry to the potter and say, no, I don't like the way you got me formed. I don't like this making. I don't like what you've done. Can the clay begin to complain to the potter? But yet, believe it or not, the clay is trying to tell the potter how to make them. Because anytime I tell God, I don't think you fix me right, he's the potter. And you are the clay. And all you can do is stay in his hands as he formed you to become what his desires is for you. This is the reason why I get real nervous sometimes when if you have a call of God in your life and all of a sudden, you know, someone can tell you something else other than what God has told you. There are a lot of people who have been people called and not God called. But if the potter is making you to be something in him, let the potter finish the work. That's why the Bible says the work I have started in you, guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to complete it. I'm going to finish what I've started. So we look in this little simple story, really. Again, I like to go back, research, look at things, because they talk about stuff that we don't even talk about. You know, we don't have no vessels of honor sitting in our houses. We don't have no different vessels of mercy. None of that. We don't have that kind of stuff sitting around our houses at all. You know, if I came to your house, you probably ain't going to wash my feet either. You're not going to wash my feet? See, I'm saying that so many things have been lost. And not that I'm saying. I don't want you to go home tonight and get you a little basin and a little water jug and sit at the front door and wash people's feet. I think, you know, that lived, it had its time, had its purpose. But I think that we glean from these things a lot. We can learn a lot about ourselves, because a lot of times in the Bible, God likens you to a lot of the artifacts, instruments, and everything else, from birds to trees. He likens you to all kinds of different things, animals. So even when it comes to vessels, we know God said we are chosen vessels. And so I need to understand vessels, because if he just called me a chosen vessel, then, you know, I'm just a human being, but I don't really understand vessels, because I don't use vessels. I'm not into vessels. If you come to my house, I do not have no water at the front door to wash your feet. Right? But just in case. No, Sister Brooke, I don't have that. So if you come, your feet nasty, you're going to leave with nasty feet. Praise God. I just want to let you know that before you come. But anyway, so what we look at these things that God has given us in Scripture, such as he gives us many different types of vessels in the Bible. He talks about, you know, there are vessels of honor, vessels of dishonor, and yet we still would not understand that if we not go back and really see in the natural what these vessels represented. Because the more I see what they represented, the more I can look at myself and realize what God is doing to this vessel here. And not only that, I can see where this vessel, whether it's sitting at the back door or the front door, or whether God has me sitting somewhere else. And so sometimes what is drawn to you, what comes to you, is because of the kind of vessel you are. Sometimes we don't understand who we are, and then we wonder why certain things are seen to come our way. And then we get upset with it because, why is this coming my way? Well, praise God. Maybe you may be a different vessel. Amen. Because there's certain things that God has to use to make certain vessels. There's things that God uses. Everything in this world, God uses to make something. Our ecosystem. I'm applauded. I ain't lying. I used to be crazy about when it came to ecosystems. And I used to get mad when he'd tell me I couldn't catch all the bass and all that. You know, I used to get angry. Man, I'm catching all. If I don't catch it, I'm just going to kill it. Well, you know, but then you got to realize something. Everything God does makes this whole world self-sustaining. You understand? So you take out one thing, you may not see what it's doing right now, but later on down the road, you realize you damaged something. So I want to be a vessel of honor. I think that everybody that will be in the kingdom of God strive, desire to be the vessel of honor. We want to be in that place called honor. Everybody desire to have the honor of being that vessel. Usually when we went back and studied this, this was this the most purchased vessel in the potter shop. Most purchased vessel because it was the most important vessel in any household. And what you need to realize, every household had to have these vessels. You know, get your mind out of 21st century. You don't have running water. If you're going to have water, you're going to go and get containers, vessels, to carry your water in. Not just your water, everything else. That's why you look over there sometimes, see them women with them great big old things on their head. I don't know how they balance that. I wish they teach these American women that. They probably wouldn't shop as much in the store then, see. Be too heavy on their neck. But anyway, they give you all sacks, and that ain't a vessel. But they carried everything in the vessels. And the first thing you would do at a household, when you get ready to make a household, you got to have a vessel of honor. You got to get that one vessel that everybody has to have. Because that vessel, you're going to put water in it, fresh, clean water. It was that vessel that when people came to your house, at the first thing happened is that you, again, in that day when people visit, you didn't let them just walk on your dirt floor with dirty feet. You washed them. It was a thing of honor. That's why even today most people shy away from washing feet because it seems so humiliating, so humbling. You mean I got to wash his feet? See, that's the thing with God. He knows how to take the pride out of us. And then to understand that when he talks about who shall stand in his house, either has what kind of hands? And the only way he ever set up for you to clean your hands was to wash another man's feet. In the process of cleaning your brother, you got to clean yourself. And being that a heart is an extension of the hand, you're not just washing with your hands, you're washing with your heart. Anyway, vessel of honor. So everybody had one at the door. Remember when Jesus came and turned the water to wine? You know what those firstkins, those vessels were? They were vessels, honor vessels. They were the vessels used at the door to wash people's feet. And there's a lot can be said just in that alone. Because the water that was in those vessels turned to wine, and wine was always a type of joy. Your greatest joy comes when you serve one another. There's a joy in serving one another. And the greatest joy, you remember when the lady came in? Nobody washed his feet. They dishonored Jesus when he came to Simon's house, and nobody washed his feet because everybody wanted to be honored. Everybody was more concerned about where they were sitting around the table than they were about doing the most humbling thing was to wash his feet. And then what did Jesus come along and do? He embarrassed them. He went and took the water basin and started washing their feet, what they should have done when they came in. Now notice this. Then they get mad. They get angry when a woman who doesn't have the honor vessel comes in less than honorable, but instead she don't have the vessel, but she got the tears. And so she decides, I'm going to wash his feet with my tears. And what if someone said? Man, if he knew what kind of woman it was. No, but he knew what kind of heart she had. And washing the feet was all about a heart thing more than just the doing thing. Oh, praise God. Anyway, just food for thought. Food for thought. So everyone that came to visit, you have the dwelling place, you poured water on them, washed their hands, and you prayed, and this fresh water was filled up every day on a daily basis. You had to put fresh water in a honor vessel every day. Fresh water in that honor vessel every day. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm telling you, is that we don't wait for the revival to get renewal. We get up every morning with fresh water in our vessels every day. You know, that's why the Bible says, be filled with the Spirit. Then a lot of people don't like to be on the vessels too long. It requires too much. You see, a lot of times that the more you serve, and you'll find this always in the church, in the place else, the more you serve, the more people want you to serve. All right? Is that not true?
Yeah.
I mean, it's not that they can't, but they see you doing it, so they want you to keep on doing it. Because that's just what happens to a vessel of honor, is that their life, their reputation is always going to be like they like to serve other people. Sometimes that works in our favor, sometimes it doesn't. Because those same vessel of honor, after a while, get burnt out. Because seem to be more required. More is being put up on them. And so these sometimes, like I said before, we have to have that daily. Not every now and then. If you're going to be a vessel of honor, you need to have a daily relationship with God. Not just every now and then. The vessel of honor, they will always make themselves available to strangers. So some people can only talk to church people. But if you become a vessel of honor, that means you can talk to everybody. Because today, it ain't always, can I quote the scripture to them? I want to be able to minister to them where they're at. And allow God, because of my relationship with him, he's going to allow me to have the right words to say to them when I talk to them. Oh, praise God. And then these will also, boy, let me put my glasses back on. And you enhance or you make other people laugh around you better. They'll be speaking negative and you'll be speaking positive. They'll always be trying to go down the hill, you'll be trying to get them up here. Because of what's in you flows out of you. See, when we begin to realize what's in us needs to flow out, you don't get all the prizes because you kept it locked up. Believe it or not, God is not pleased if you go and hide it. He is never happy because you kept it clean. He wants you to release it and let it go. So these people, the vessel of honor, is that they're always going to be, through their life, through their words, they're going to be given words of life. Wherever you go, wherever you be. Look for the opportunity. I don't care where you are in a grocery store. It may not be that you said anything about Jesus. You just may have said something real nice like, have a great day. Isn't God good or something? Anything. It ain't always preaching. Sometimes we think if we don't put our preaching suit on and put on getting our preaching voice and get real sanctimonious that we ain't done nothing. But see, sometimes just a gentle word, a right word. In the right season. That's all. Then we have the vessels of mercy. They look just like the vessel of honor, but they're not put at the front door. These vessels of mercy is usually put in the middle of the city. Because one thing we fail to realize as Christians, now, I believe we can have all these qualities of these vessels. But we need to realize one thing. Who needs to know the mercy of God more than the world that we say is lost? So God puts them in the middle of the city. It wasn't a church thing. It wasn't a temple thing. It was to whosoever will. Remember when Jesus stood up, last day of the feast, being a vessel, whosoever will, let him come and drink. He was right in the middle of the city trying to show them that I am a vessel of mercy. It's not about your church. It's not about what church you went to. Every stranger that wanted to drink could come and drink from the vessel of mercy that's placed in the middle of the city. Praise God. And many of you now, some of the things that you don't understand, you sometimes people fight about where God placed you. We get upset because, man, I'm working around a whole bunch of sinners, man. All they do is cuss, cuss, cuss. Well, maybe God got you in the middle of them so that you can be the vessel. Isn't it strange is that the thing we run from is the very one God wants to say? And here we are on a job. They mess with my Jesus, man. They just be talking all crazy and going on, man. Why don't you talk uncrazy? I mean, God got you in the middle of something. Man, I'm working out here at Stadiums. When I got saved, man, them boys work, they bad. But I didn't believe God wanted me to leave them. He saved me there. I finally realized one thing, you know, even though they laughed at me a lot, they laughed a long time for a minute, taking bets and all kind of stuff. They're laughing. Oh, yeah, they were laughing. But I stayed true. I just kept on. And I probably didn't handle it right because I went in and I preached to them every time I went into the locker room. I'd be standing on top of that bench telling them, okay, y'all, Jesus is going to get every last one of y'all. Yeah, y'all going to burn. That's it. I may not have told them the right thing. But I did want God to do something to them because they're laughing at me. But you know what? It's that after a while, all those people that laughed at me, every last one of them that laughed at me, eventually came to me like Nicodemus. They come in, they telling me stuff. One guy, I would never thought he ever went to church. He came in one night, we sat down, he closed the door to my little office and said, you know, how you used to go to church? I said, huh, you did? Yeah. Found out he even had spoken tongues. All this stuff. And then he told me, you know, he said, man, I admire you. And I said, just hold on. Because sometimes where God has you, and sometimes we think we need to be someplace else to be a better Christian. You've been the best Christian you can be where God placed you. I believe that. Because God didn't just accidentally save you and didn't know you're going to be in that position. He didn't have to place you where you are and somehow messed up, saved you too quick. But we have this idea, well, you know, I could be saved. I had to work around them. No, God can save you in Babylon. God put them in Babylon. I know we can't quite compute that in our minds, but that's like going from night to day or from day to night. You are stepping back. I'm talking about way back. They didn't even have a church service. They didn't have all that, nothing going on. But God kept them. So it's not where you are. It's where you know God is. And so this chosen vessel, no, not chosen, but I mean, where was I at? Oh, the vessel of mercy. I was on that, yeah. Man, my eyesight is bad tonight. I got to put the glasses on. Sometimes we're praying, God, deliver me from this ungodly person. Ain't that always a prayer, especially if somebody getting on our last nerve? We're praying for deliverance. Lord, do whatever you do. I don't care what you got to do. Just get rid of them. God ain't trying to get rid of nobody. He's trying to get you changed. He wants you to show what a vessel of mercy looks like. Because you see, he put up with you. We forget that sometimes. You know what I'm saying? He put up with us for a long time. We can't put up with nobody for 15 minutes. And he's saying, see, my vessel of mercy, I've been putting up with you for a long time. Now, I know. Don't just keep looking this way. I know. I ain't never gave God no hard time. That's what you said. You know, I know since we got DVDs down here, I'm sure in heaven they got more high-tech stuff. Maybe we can go back when we get there and look at all our life so we can laugh. Yeah, we can laugh. So here, one of the things about that chosen vessel, let's go down to that. This is the one that everybody wants to be. This is the one that really the potter is so proud of because he got such beauty. He took such time to make it. This chosen vessel is one of the most beautiful pieces in the whole pottery shop. It's not just any piece you're going to walk in and just buy. Matter of fact, they said when you went in to get a chosen vessel is that you had to tell the potter this is what you want because he didn't have it out on the shelves. He didn't have it out on the top shelves where all his other vases and vessels are. He had it always back in a back room in some little dark corner, secluded away from everything. And he would go back because you asked for it. And if you didn't ask for it, you didn't get it. But he asked for it, and he'd go back and get that little vessel and bring it out. And this thing here, when he made it, he meticulously made it, put enough fire on it. You know, everything about God, it has to do with fire. A lot of that fire stuff. Fire always brings out whatever's in whatever. If you want to find out if you got pure gold, all you need is a good fire. Do you know there ain't a whole lot of pure gold? See, you know, I know somebody said, I got a gold ring. Well, I bet you it ain't pure, though. Yeah, they told me it was. I said, it ain't pure. Because really, pure gold is hard to work with. It's real soft. And so they had to put other stuff with it to make it whole a form. So pure gold, and then pure gold is even more palatable, but it's heavy. One thing about pure gold, you got to burn it until one guy say, the smith say you burn it until you're able to see your reflection in it. When you see your reflection in it, you know now it's pure. Think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which come to try you, knowing it's the trying of your faith. And that faith that's tried becomes like pure gold. Think it not strange. See, God wants to see himself in you. The only way he can see himself in you, he has to burn out all the other stuff that's not like him. And what fire does, I don't care how pretty that gold is. When they put it on the fire, all the little stuff in that ain't supposed to be in there kind of come up to the top. Floats up. And he reaches in. Because you know what happened? You know, when you're going through a fiery trial, what you realize started floating up to the top. Have you ever noticed that? You can talk about, you can speak in tongues all you want to when you're playing the piano. But when you get in a fiery trial, if tongues ain't in you then, it ain't floating up. But the fiery trial tells you, you know, it's not like God sends a fiery trial to kill you. But the fiery trial is to bring out of you everything that's not like him. And you don't know what's in you until the fire is on you. You thought you trusted God until the fire came. You thought you really believed in God until the fire came. There's a whole lot of things you thought until the fire came. Brother Wilson, you just make it so hard. No, I'm not making it hard. This is easy. Because he's going to try me, and then he's going to make me like pure gold. He's going to look down and see his image and be so happy. Because that's what he wants to see. And the more I fight him, it ain't helping my case now. Because God is more determined to see his image than I want to show it. And so he don't run out of trials. You'll never exhaust him in anything. You want to exhaust his blessing, and you want to exhaust the trial. So let me see your memo today. Think it not strange. Because if you're going to become a vessel of honor, the thing you need to realize, there's a lot of fire involved in that. And a lot of times you're laying it on yourself before you're really there, but there's a lot of trials involved in becoming that vessel, that chosen vessel of honor. And not only that, sometimes you wonder, because when God is working, because he ain't always working as fast as everybody else is working. People will see things and they want you to shoot. Go, 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 go. No, God ain't working like that. You know, they got you running down 94. They got you running 94 already, and God ain't there yet. He's just still working. He's still making the chosen vessel. He's still demonstrating with that chosen vessel. See, a lot of times that he let that, once he fires it up and get it all prettied up, he set it in obscurity, set away from everything. And you're wondering, you know, what's really hard is when you know you got so much in you that you want everybody to know it and you can't tell nobody. You can't find nobody to really tell. And it seemed like everybody's gone but you. You're sitting in obscurity. You're sitting in a dark place. Seemed like nobody's ever, just you and God. But you are a chosen vessel, and God is still maturing you to use you like he wants to use you. A lot of times it's that in a chosen vessel's life, you got a stricter discipline. You know, I used to get mad myself personally because I thought everybody should be reading the Bible as much as I read it. Just keep looking like this. And I'll get mad because I know they wasn't reading it like me. I know they wasn't. I would get upset. You need to read your Bible. You need to read your Bible. Well, see, you know, and then I realized one thing. Your call sometimes dictates you a whole lot of activity, spiritual activities in your life. You're going to have a love for the Word of God, but some of you are not going to have the love for the Word of God like I would probably, or like Lachelle or somebody else in here that was involved in ministry. You know why? When you're in the ministry, that's on your head all the time. You can't even have a good, I mean, not even a bad day and not be thinking about seeing something. I mean, your whole life is built. God is always dropping stuff into your heart. You go and look at a wreck and the people screaming and hollering and you're seeing a lesson. It's hard for me to sit in a classroom and listen to people teach because they say one thing, man, my system went off. I had to relax and enjoy, just get in some word. I just have to enjoy that. But see, you don't understand when you're a vessel of honor is that you have such strict discipline. You don't let anything come between you and what you know your purpose is. Nothing alters that. You don't allow nothing to change it. You can have a family reunion. You're going to reunion with them, and you're going to come back, and you're going to do what you need to do because the next day is Sunday. Oh, praise God. But we're talking about a chosen vessel. Sometimes it seems that they're more committed, more intense, but then again, I quit trying to figure out what kind of vessel people are and just try to figure out what kind of vessel I am. I'm not going to try to put my strict discipline upon you because you may not have that same call. You know, it's just like Paul, when Paul was called. You remember what he said about Paul? Now, he didn't say it about Pete, but he said about Paul. He said, man, this is the chosen vessel. I've chosen this vessel. And that he's going to bear my name, and he's going to suffer some things for my name's sake. Now, I mean, he specifically told him that. Was told Ananias that. You know, I'm not sure he's told Paul that. Paul just knew he was called. But Ananias said, When he told Ananias, he's a chosen vessel, all right. Yeah, this is my boy. But I'm going to put my name on him. Because one of the things about being a chosen vessel, what made that vessel so unique, what it was the only piece in the whole pottery shack that had the name of the potter on it. He was so pleased with that vessel that before he sent it out the door and sold it, he'd write his name on the bottom of it to make sure that everybody knows this is not just any vessel, this is my vessel. That's what he told Paul. I'm going to put my name on it. Chosen vessel to bear my name. And all the things Paul had to go through. And sometimes when I look at these kind of things, I wonder, how do we think that all this stuff God has for us, sometimes we just, the least little things seem to knock us off course. And yet, we don't know. Maybe he said the same thing about you. Maybe he said, you know what, this is my chosen vessel. I'm going to put my name on it. They're going to go through some things for me, but they're my chosen vessel. How do we know he didn't say that about us? And it might be that every time a trial comes, instead of looking at it as a trial, see it as a triumph. And realize that, you know what? God chose me. I am a chosen vessel of God. And I know that since I'm going to bear his name, I may have to go through some things. But see, I already know the other side of the story. I already know the end of the story. I already know the end of this thing. The end of the event still is the same. I really do win. Oh, praise God. You know, in the Bible, it talks about in Luke chapter 12, verse 48. We're going to read that. And he says, he said, and the servant which knew his 47 Lord's will and prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. He that knew not and did commit things worthy of stripes shall be beaten with few stripes. For to whom whosoever much is given, of him shall be much required, and whom men have committed much of him, they will ask the more. And basically, like I've said before, I go back and look at the Ark of the Covenant. When the Philistines took it, how God allowed them to handle it and didn't do a thing to them. Did not kill not one person. Not one Philistine died from touching the Ark. Not one. One Jew. Touched that ark, killed it. He knew better. He's supposed to know better. He was the priesthood. They're supposed to know better. And that's a lot of things even with us. Sometimes, you know, everybody in church ain't grown. Some of us are still kids. As simple as that. As the things that the Philistines may do, they may get away with it, but you know better. So we have to be careful and make sure that we're not getting whooped with a few stripes because we know better, or many stripes because we know better. See, there, he didn't punish them personally. Yeah, he did give them a little hemorrhoids and stuff. Did make them uncomfortable, but they touched it. One Jew touches and he dies. We can't handle the things of God like everybody. That's why I hate it when people try to commercialize church to the place where it's a man's idea about it, and they go about trying to make church according to man's idea. We need not touch stuff that God ain't created like that. Let's just make sure that what God is doing, God is doing. We don't need to be trying to touch his glory. Just let his glory be revealed. Let's not mess with stuff that belongs to God and God alone. That's what I said on the pulpit the other morning, because I know how a lot of times in our own self-inflicted prejudice about different things. Whether I like this type of worship or that type of worship. Matter of fact, we got churches now is that they got two kinds, old kind and new kind. There's really only one kind. Really only one kind. I don't believe you got a traditional and what they call it? Contemporary. Because in our time, we're going to worship. Now, let me just say this here. It is a known fact. I don't, it's one thing I ain't going to have behind nothing. I will tell you this here. There would have been a time in my life when I did. I would talk against everything that I thought wasn't God. But like I said before, if you go back and read the Bible, and then the Bible shows you something different, you got to change. And you'll be a fool not to. I go back to the Bible, and I'm reading over here in the Bible. First of all, in Acts chapter 15, which is a New Testament scripture, says that God is going to raise back up the ruins of the tabernacle of David. So now, if I wanted to know how to have church, which church would I study, Moses' church or David's? But isn't it strange is that we're trying to resurrect Moses' tabernacle instead of trying to get into David's tabernacle. God is only working with one. He ain't working with both of them. He's only working with David's tabernacle. So when I go back, now, I don't want to take anything for granted, so what do? Guess what I do? I go back and look at David's tabernacle. And you know what was really strange when I looked at his tabernacle? His tabernacle wasn't even in church. His tabernacle was not blocked by a high priest. There was not anything between you and that ark. And one of the things that David instituted is that he had courses of worshipers, dancers, and singers. That there was never a time when there wasn't anybody around that ark dancing and singing in their courses. He made sure 24/7 somebody was praising God. In Moses' tabernacle, the only time they ever praise is after a victory. You never went inside Moses' tabernacle and shouted. Matter of fact, that's where we get being quiet in church from. Shh, shh, you may wake up God. Shh, shh, you don't wake God up. Don't wake him up, we having church. Yeah, we laughing. But we act like the only time we want to wake up God is when we got a victory. That's what the Jews done. Now, when they had a victory or trying to manipulate God into giving them a victory, they tore the place up. Do-do, do-do, do-do. But they, on a daily basis, there were no praises. There was nobody shouting. There was nobody lifting their hands. They went all week long, nobody praising God at all. But you would never see David's tabernacle. You would never see David's tabernacle without somebody praising God every day. And there was nothing that separated them from God. And what God wanted us to realize, instead of building up that Moses tabernacle where the veil still exists, where you're still separated from God, where you're still trying to find God, and one day you hope to get behind the veil and see the glory of God. No, David said, no, man, I can see this all the time. That's why the Bible said, I've made you kings and priest. But you won't know how to be a king till you first know how to be a priest. You learn how to be a priest through praise and worship. And in doing so, in the presence of God, you learn how to be a king. Then you learn how to command things instead of begging for stuff. King never beg. You'll never hear a king begging. Would y'all please? King didn't beg. King made decrees. King proclaimed. What am I saying to us? That's the reason I know we have to change. No, stop praying. No, but learn how to pray properly. And instead of begging, start proclaiming so that your word, the words of a king, is law. If he made you a priest and a king, what are you begging for? And especially when he done said, I've given you all things that pertain to life and godliness. Praise God. So the chosen vessel has his name on it. God wants to put his name. Remember over there in the book of Revelation, and he that overcometh. He said, I'm going to write my Father's name. Then the church of Laodicea, said they were naked. They were rich, had everything, had need of nothing, but they were naked, blind. You see, the thing about it is that many of us are trying to tell God the same thing. That's why we need to realize what kind of vessel he's making, because he will allow this stuff to come out of us that's keeping us back. God knows what he's doing. We're called a chosen vessel. We're going to live a strict alliance. You know, you go in that potter shop in Jerusalem. He puts his name on it. That means it's a special vessel. In Acts chapter 9, verse 15, same thing he said to Paul. He's going his way. He's a chosen vessel. I wish to God he'd say the same thing about all of us. I want his name to be on me. I want his name to be on my forehead, not just on the bottom, on my forehead. I want his mind in me. His name, his mind, that name on my forehead means that my mind has been changed. And many times we find our place as a chosen vessel. We find a place, seem like God has got us on back burners all the time. Seem like you're always out of sight. Seem like it's always someone else other than you. And sometimes, being in the fire, because God, being a chosen vessel, you're going to go through the fire. Ain't no ifs, ands, and buts about it. You will go through the fire. It's not a matter if. You will go through the fire. As a matter of fact, he even says in a minor prophet, he said, I'm going to take them all through. And then when he talked about then, he said, I'm going to take them all through, and on the third will come out. But you see, now he's been through the fire for you. He's already done the firing for you. So even what kind of fire you're going to come through is still not going to be at all equal to what it could be. But you will go through the fire, right? If you don't think you're going to go through the fire, you might as well back up now. Everything in the kingdom of God, when they went in and they captured the enemy's country, captured their land, the one thing God told them is this. He said, I'll tell you what I'll do. Anything that you can put in the fire and it remains after the fire is out is yours. Hebrew boys in a furnace. Guess what they went in with? They went in with rope on the hand, rope on the feet, thing on the head. Guess what? They came out without ropes on the hand and ropes on the feet. That's what God's fire does. It takes off you the things that you couldn't take off yourself. It things that got you bound up, and you don't even realize how bound you are, but his fire is what frees you. And in that, they came out, they didn't even smell like the fire they've been in. Had no smell of their trial. Sometimes we come out of a trial and we still know you came out of one because we still smell it. You won't let us forget it. All right, now, they came out, no smell of anything. But what they did come out with, they were free. The trials you're going to go through really come to set you free. Because you don't know how much of you is involved in you. Sometimes we got a lot of us in us that has to come out of us. A lot of us. See, I quit lying to myself. I had to look at myself. I know the difference between Kelly Wilson and Jesus Christ. And I know when Kelly shows up. I can tell. He tried to show up today. I smacked him back down. I said, I got to go to church tonight. You know, almost got upset. I know that ain't Jesus. I know it wasn't Jesus. Now I can sit there and mull over all I want to, but I know it ain't Jesus. So we've got to realize a lot of our problem is us. It's too much of us and not enough of him. He guarantees me peace, but his peace. And what I've got, when I got too much of me, I can't find that peace. Oh, praise God. It's like when we come out of the fire, it's like the more you've been through a trial, the easier you are to recognize or to minister to people. Like I said, I think it was last week, is that a lot of time, is that what God wants you to know is not just for you. It ain't just for you. Don't take it personal. As they say, it's just business. A lot of things I'm going through and you're going to go through, it ain't even for you. It's for somebody else. Because God has called you to be a chosen vessel. And this chosen vessel is going to be able to minister to all kinds of people. But if you don't, if you've never been through a trial, how can you tell somebody how to get out of it? Don't even try to talk to me. Oh, yeah, you can get out, man. Well, yeah, how you know? Well, I just know you can. I sung about it in church. You know, I believe in shouting before the victory. But I really believe in that. I ain't just saying that. I really believe I can shout before I see it. Uh-oh. Don't wait till the battle's over. Shout now. Y'all saying that, sir? Huh? Y'all don't say that song? Don't say that song. You ain't never heard that one? Yeah, that was a big song back way back, man. Everybody was jumping and shouting on the song. But the reality of it is that there was a real battle going on. And most people wasn't shouting when in the battle. Shout before it, you be shouting through it, and you be shouting when it's over. Praise God. Oh, praise God. Sometimes we go through more than others. There are times when, we want to be a refreshing. We want to refresh people. You want to see people do better. Your whole desire is to see people grow. You want to see the development of God in the life. And this sometimes can be so, I won't say frustrating, but it can be overwhelming. Because you know how simple, the more you see God, you know how simple this thing become. And it hurts to watch people look like fish out of a water trying to get their next breath. When you know all they got to do is get in the water and swim. All you got to do is get in and swim. And when you get in and swim, you'll find out it's not that hard. But I know somehow you make it simple and then it's too simple. People say, I understand, but how did you do that? Well, I don't know. I can't tell you all that. All I know, you just keep walking with God, and the more you walk, he reveals the simpler it becomes. All of a sudden, you're not sitting there second-guessing God every day. You're not sitting here trying to figure God out. He done got you already figured out. Now I'm going to trust him. Praise God. And so after a while, you learn what the word contentment means. You know what that word means? But you will learn. Because, see, our minds are always scattered and always reaching. We'll never, ever satisfy. We can buy a new couch this year and see something come out next year and swear the other one we just got is old. Nothing will never, ever content. I think somewhere in our life, we do have to find a place of contentment. A vessel of honor finally finds that place. Understand, being content is not necessarily just putting up with any old junk. But you do have to find a place in life where, you know, I'm content. You know, they came out. You got people standing in the library right now. What's the next phone they got coming out? That's 772 or something? Huh? What more can they do? Huh? They got people standing around the corner waiting on a telephone. I am just as happy with my LG, whatever it is. It when I hit it, it calls. I text it and it'll text. I can even take pictures and videos. Now what else do I need? Huh? Is it gonna dry for me? Scratch my back when it get itchy? Huh? But I'm saying what are we doing? What are they doing for us? You can't do no more than talk on. Well, I guess you can do a little bit more. Hmm? Yeah, but I'm just saying though, I got that on my old phone. It works real good. I say they ain't give you no new GPS because America ain't changed. America didn't change, highways ain't changed. So what am I getting new? So I'm just saying, what am I getting new? Can anybody tell me? Because it seemed like somebody, they, when I heard on the news, they was around the corners waiting on a phone. Don't take, one guy took off work to even be the first in line to get a phone to do what? Call somebody. Guess what, man? I got a phone. I got one too. That's why you're calling me. Notice how mine sound, your sound, same way. I'm just saying though. But being a chosen vessel, you're going to have to find a place of contentment. You got to find a place where, you know, you ain't got to have all the toys in the box to be satisfied. You got to find a place where, you know, styles, everything changes over and over. And you know, I'm not a style guru, none of that kind of stuff. You know, I make my own styles. I do. I'm wearing stuff now that's 20 years old, some of it. Not all of it. I just blend it in with the new. No, I am through. Now I am content. I am content with God. I am content with what he's been able to do. I'm content. That's what chosen vessel will become. You eventually become content because if not, you're going to always be scattered. Your mind is going every place but where it needs to be. And a lot of times you'll find out things look like it's close to you now, but see, I know better. Paul spent 17 years on the backside of the desert. Looked like things was closed for him, but the Bible says he was a chosen vessel. It looked like here he is on the backside of a desert with all this power to preach the gospel, and he's back on the backside of a desert wondering, what am I doing back here? But at the same time, he's got a relationship with Jesus. He got 3.5 years, him and Jesus, just talking. He was one of those apostles that didn't walk with him, but got with him later. 17 years. Now, you can imagine when he first got touched by God, how excited that was, because he went to Jerusalem. He was getting ready to preach revival. He was getting ready to turn it out. Only find out they weren't receiving it and try to kill it. That's real confusing, because here it was, they're trying to kill him, and he come with the message of God, but they're trying to kill him. So he ends up going out to Arabia on the backside over there for 17 years. They tell me he spent out there. Only thing he doing is making tents. Many people would have said, man, your ministry is shot. What are you waiting on? Well, see, the same God that called him, we're going to be the same one to talk to him again. And so here Paul look like an obscurity, but when God got ready for him, see, a lot of times you got to get ready, be ready when God is ready. A lot of times we're trying to get ready, but God is preparing you for what you're going to do long before you get there. A lot of our trials today ain't about just right now. It ain't about this moment. It's more than that. It's bigger than that. There are things going on in you right now that you're going to have answers for people that need to know. Things that you thought you didn't know, you're learning. Because you got to know this for yourself. And so when you look at things like it ain't open for you, don't worry about that. If you're a chosen vessel of God, eventually, when God gets ready, it will be open. Then you have the clean vessel. They used to be the vessel of honor. The clean vessel used to be the vessel of honor. But what they done, you know, sometimes when you get out of balance, that's when I say now, I don't just be talking about I'm serving God. You got to get in a place of relationship with God. You just can't be the best pie cooker in the church. You know what I'm saying? I appreciate it. Love your pies. Love your cakes. But you just can't be that. You got to have a relationship. Because what happens to people that used to be vessel of honor, they just kept making pies. Nah, I shouldn't even use that one. But they just kept serving. And what happens to these vessels after a while, that the more you serve out of it, like you pour on water, the lip on it becomes messed up. Can't pour right. Vessels become marred. So the clean vessel become really an old vessel of honor. But now it's not at the front door anymore. It's moved to the back door. Now it becomes a vessel now in which when you wash your hands in the honored vessel, the old water goes into the clean vessel now instead of it used to hold the clean water. So in essence, now you have become more of a garbage pail than you are a true vessel. Because they put you in the kitchen, all the old food goes in that vessel, and they take it outside and dump it. There's a whole lot of things been caked on the side and needs to be scraped out. And so that vessel now is at the back door instead of the front door. It's filled full of stuff. That's the reason why I tell you now, you can mess up your vessel by what you allow to be put in it. Let me say that again. You can mess your vessel up by what you allow to be put in your vessel. That's the reason why I'm going to say this and I'm going to move. You know, there's two words that almost sound alike, but they're not. They got the first three letters alike, one called gospel, another called gossip. Sometimes we confuse the two. Gossip is not gospel. But it will mess your vessel up. I think Paul made a statement like, I don't want to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's what I want to know. More than anything. I want to know Jesus Christ. What comes out of me, I want it to bring light. That's the reason why the lip on a clean vessel was cracked, broken, worn, can't pour right. And that's the reason why it was put at the back door. Because the lip has to be able to flow right. Bible say this tongue here, this vessel, this words, life and death. What flows out of you is either going to cause people to live or die. I want to make sure that what comes out of me is the good news called the gospel. You're not going to be saved on somebody else's stuff. I need the good news. Is there a question coming? It got warm tonight, didn't it? Praise God. Any comment, question, statement? Okay, well, I'm going to let this go then. You sure? All right. Shake hands. Be friendly.